the stage. So Sheree Pepper, y'all come on down. February the 2nd, be here. Are y'all ready for real church? Are you ready for real church? That's better. That's better. All right. Woo. I missed you guys. It seems like it's been like 2 weeks since I've been here because it has been 2 weeks since I've been here. I love y'all. You know, people have a total misconception about church and the people that go there. You know, a lot of people, I mean, y'all know, y'all are out there, every one of you, y'all been in the outside world, and you know how people talk about the holy rollers and better than thou and everything else. You know, church isn't about being better than anybody. We're here because we want Jesus Christ to better us. This room right now is slap full of cheaters and liars and abusers and users, and I'm one of them, just like the rest of y'all, you know. But I want God, I want Him to change me in my heart, and I want to be a lasting and effective change, and that's why I'm here. And I hope every one of you are here for the same reasons. Amen. Amen. He has a plan for all of us, right? Yes. That's right, that's right. So, do I have a volunteer tonight? Or do I need to appoint someone for our vision? Wait, we got to do God's good. I'm sorry, ladies. I can't forget God's good. Yeah, my bad. All right, so I'll let y'all lead, all right? Y'all ready? 1, 2, 3.
God is good!
All the time!
All the time!
God is good!
Woo! Miss Treva, I didn't see you open your mouth over there. Are you sandbagging? If they was louder, you was going to join in, right? I always got to pick on Miss Treve. I love her. All right, so do I have a volunteer?
Guy.
Which one? Red shirt, you got a cross around your neck? I mean, you're walking the walk. Let's see if you can talk the talk.
Our vision is to reach the lost for Christ, meet the needs of our community, and impact our world with love, truth, and grace.
Good job, my man. Good job. All right. He was on point there. Can all of y'all say that with me, please? Our vision is to reach the lost for Christ, meet the needs of our community, and impact our world with love, truth, and grace. And whose responsibility is that? That's right. Every day. If you have not already, please fill out a connection card by the back door right there. If you have a decision you need to make or a prayer request, anything like that, put it on there. We'll get in touch with you. You guys also follow along with our daily bread. Does anybody know what our daily bread was today?
100 years from now.
Huh?
It was 100 years from now.
100 years from now. What happens 100 years from now? Oh, you just read the title, huh? Yeah. She's on. She picked up the Clef notes here on the way to service tonight. She had that feeling. If you'd like to know more about 100 years from now, pick up a copy out there in our lobby or getreal.church. There's also an app that you can download on your phone.
It was about doing something that people will remember you 100 years from now. And the only thing anybody's going to ever remember 100 years from now, if we still here, is what we've done for Jesus.
That's right. And what's left on Facebook? See, y'all be careful before y'all post stuff. Please take a soldier home. We have a briefcase out there in our lobby. Take a little plastic soldier. Put it on a briefcase, nightstand somewhere. Whenever you see that little soldier, take a few moments and say a prayer for our military personnel that are serving out there, as well as our first responders. His Way Youth Service, Sundays, 10:30 a.m., Wednesdays, 6:30 p.m. Y'all please give our youth a round of applause. First and third Fridays of the month, we have what, Miss Treva? Do y'all have fun at the sewing circle? I could only imagine being in a small room with y'all two ladies. It would be a hoot. I could imagine. Yeah. Well, if I'm ever off on a Friday between 9 and 11, you're not going to do Fridays no more. Well, I highly doubt I'll ever be off on one. But, yeah, if y'all would like to learn how to sew or need anything altered, anything like that, see one of those ladies right there. They'll take care of you. Third Tuesday of the month, we have the Bible with Brother Bruce right here at the church, 6:30 p.m. Please bring a side item. Is Bruce out there in the lobby? I don't know what he's making for the main dish there, but I'll find out and we'll forward it. What?
Lemon pepper chicken.
Roast chicken.
Lemon pepper chicken.
Lemon pepper chicken. All right, all right. So bring a side dish to accompany that. Second Saturday of the month, 7:30 a.m., men's prayer breakfast. We are changing the location. We're going to have it right here at the church. So please come on down. Don't go over to, all the way to Sock Choppy out there. If you did hit that, you went too far. They still got a good breakfast out there, but better prayer and better food is going to be over here, right?
Whoop, whoop.
Is somebody going to bring me some maple bacon donuts from next door over there? That's all I want.
If they got any in stock, we'll have bacon donuts. But I heard that there's a national bacon shortage. Yeah. Ms. Carol just told me about. Definitely need to put that on the prayer list.
Small group movies. We're going to have that Saturday, April the 11th at the Regal Movie Theaters at 12:20. Tell me about that. That's a new one. I hadn't seen that one before.
They are showing Jesus by Sights and Sound Theaters. They're going to live stream it, so there'll be a live performance at the Sights and Sounds Theaters, but it's live streaming to Regal through Fathom Events.
Okay, fantastic, fantastic.
Yeah, we'll meet at 12:20, and the movie starts at 12:55.
And what is the location of Regal Movie Theater?
Governor Square Mall.
Governor Square Mall, all right.
It's right behind it.
Woohoo. Next Steps, new membership classes are going to be on January the 12th. If you'd like to join our wonderful church family here, please stay after our service that day.
I hear we have two individuals signed up for a new membership class. And
fantastic.
If there's anybody else interested in signing up, please see JJ after the service.
Awesome.
So tap. Excited about it.
Woohoo! Are you excited about it? That's the most excited I've ever seen Tap in my entire life right there.
Yeet yeet!
Baptism service will be February the 9th. If you'd like to get dipped in that heavenly water out there, stay after service. We got a list out there you can put your name on of, and or you can just stay after service and be ready to go that day. You can follow along on Facebook. Hi, Facebook and YouTube and all you guys that are out there watching us like that right now. We appreciate y'all. Come on down and visit us sometime.
Happy birthday to you.
Birthdays.
Happy birthday to you.
Do we have any birthdays? We got one. We got two. I know it ain't your birthday. Yours is July.
I'm standing in.
Stand in, huh?
Happy birthday to you.
Is it your birthday? We got two standing.
I'm standing in for my mother-in-law. She's going to be a beautiful 29 years old.
We need,
on Friday.
I know she's watching this live right now, so you need to say that in Indonesian so she can understand you.
Yeah. Hold on. Oh, yeah. Selamat ulang tahun, mama.
All right. And what do we got, Tat?
My nephew's turning 22 on the 10th.
Woohoo!
How is it your nephew and my mother-in-law are almost the same age?
It's the Indonesian years.
It's the Indonesian years, okay. That's like leap years, right?
Mikey, we need you, buddy. Come on.
I just want to go on record, since it is my mother in Indonesia's birthday coming up, I just want to go on record letting everybody know I'm really happy my wife favors her and not her father. Thank you, Papa.
She totally did not understand. I need that in Indonesian, please. All right, do we have any anniversaries out there this week? Anybody got a special day? Nope. All right. JJ.
I need JJ.
He needs JJ.
Yeah,
I
need JJ
something. Don't say nothing, Mikey.
Where's JJ at? Right here. JJ, I need you a second.
Oh, Lord. Yeet, yeet.
Yeet, yeet.
too, buddy.
My mom went to the nursery room today. She had blood work today. My mom's neighbors be her right there today. She had blood work today. And after that, my dad had a back hurting.
So your mom's, we need to pray for your parents.
Yes.
You want to pray for them right now? Everybody, let's all pray for Mikey's parents, okay? Dear Heavenly Father, Lord God, we come together, Lord. We lift up Mikey's parents, Miss Barbara, Lord God. We just ask that you heal her from the top of her head to the tips of her toes, Father God. But we ask that you put your supernatural healing on this family, Lord God. They need you more than ever. Lord, we ask that you continue to strengthen them and just move them in a mighty way, Lord. And we ask that you strengthen our brother Mikey, Lord. We love him so much, Lord. And we just thank you for his devotion to us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen.
All right, praise reports, prayer requests. What we got? Hands up everywhere.
Oh, hey, we have a birthday that didn't get stood in the gap for. James, you forgot to stand in for your dad. He's turning 78. You need to go stand in for your dad. Come on, James.
One more time, Mikey.
One more birthday, Mikey.
One more birthday. James is turning 78.
We forgot that.
Scooter. Hold on. Alexis's birthday is Sunday. Yes. She might be busy doing something else. We'll sing again on Sunday. Do you feel like somebody's watching you, James?
Are there any more birthdays out there?
I'm sure there are, but maybe it's not here. Right?
All right. Praise reports. Here we come.
We made $1,400, close to $1,400 yesterday at the store. Almost every piece of furniture has a sold sticker on it. Yes, it was a very good day. And y'all just keep me and my kids in your prayers. Friday morning, we're going to an evaluation at a psychologist. So I just pray it goes better than last time. So y'all just keep us in your prayers.
Amen.
I got one. I want to make sure everybody can hear this. Brandon's on his way home right now.
I just want to praise the Lord for the good food that we had at the women's meeting on Monday night, and the homemade biscuits were awesome, Ted. Thank you.
I just want to thank God. I just want to thank God for everything that he's doing in my life. And I have a praise report for my dad. He's in the hospital with pneumonia in his lungs.
Prayer request. What's your dad's name? What's your dad's name?
Ricky.
Ricky.
Ricky Land.
Ricky Land. Keep Ricky Land in your prayers.
I want to give out a praise request for my brother Gary's son, Josh, being deployed. With what we have going on overseas, everybody pray for his son. That God keeps his hedge of protection around him.
Amen.
I need a prayer request for my little girl Annabella. Help my granny too.
Granny's Amen.
Granny's name is Mary. Mary Jason.
Praise reports, prayer requests.
I just want everybody to keep my mama Brenda in your prayers and my aunt Jennifer Smith. She has lymphoma and she's not responding very well to the treatments. And also Jerry, I would like everybody just to keep him in your prayers.
Thank you. I have a praise report. I tell you, I think my children or my family might be under attack a little because I know that the Lord's been blessing us and teaching them and bringing them into a more intimate relationship. My daughter hit a black bear the other night, Sunday night, coming home from Gainesville, and she just got done praying and said she had not, I know I haven't talked to you in a while, Lord, that kind of thing, and she had prayed for protection and safety, and then 10 minutes later, she hit the bear. And the thing about it is that the damage to the car was only cosmetic. There was no mechanical damage, and of course, nothing to her, you know, besides stress, I guess. And then we took her car, obviously, to the mechanic the next day, and come to find out her timing chain is on. They wouldn't even start the car up to move it into the shop. They pushed it. That's how serious the timing chain was. My other daughter's car was breaking down too. Felt like the wheels was going to fall off. And sure enough, we found out the tires were separating from the rims. And she's already had one incident where she lost a tire. And so both of those were dangerous situations. And so, and when people look at the Lord, they say, well, I just prayed to you, Lord, and then you let me hit this black bear, you know. At least they don't accuse God. But the point is that God allowed it to happen to show her, I got you, Carly. You know, it's like these things happen. They appear bad to the world, but when you're living for the Lord, you know that he's got a better good in it, or he's communicating to you. It's like these girls are, you know, the Lord's got them, and I just praise God for that. And I do pray that he'll keep my brother, Kenny. He's struggles with alcohol. I pray that, you know, that he will open his eyes to the Lord and stop drinking.
Amen.
Amen. Any more praise? There we go.
I just want to thank God for what he's done in my life this far. And he's definitely put love on a totally different level. It's a great thing to have God in your life. And my daughters are watching. I love you, and make sure you forward this to your brother. I love you, son. Thank you.
Amen.
Amen. Any more praise reports, prayer requests?
Keep my nephew. His name is Harold Parker III. In y'all's prayer, he's fell on some barbed wire, and it cut him up pretty bad.
Amen. All right, Ed, I will hand it over to you.
Father, we just thank you for seeing us through another day, Lord, giving us another opportunity, another chance. Help us to continue, Lord, and make the right choices and continue to follow your lead. Lord, we thank you for putting the desire in our hearts to be your faithful and obedient servants. As always, Lord, we lay all these requests at your feet. We give all our problems and burdens to you, for you're the only one that can carry the load. And we know, Lord, that you're going to do this for us because you love us and we believe in you. So, Lord, take this message tonight where you want it to go. Let us learn what's good from it and continue to use it in our lives to be better for you and your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen, amen, amen. Let's all stand up and greet one another. Find somebody you haven't seen in a moment or two. Hug their neck and tell them Jesus loves you. And everybody needs to look at Tony's shirt. Amen, amen, amen. We may be seated. You really should have got all that on camera, the two cameramen trying to find their way back to the booth, running into all those obstacles and tripping over each other. Yeah, that's what it looked like. Yep. Yep. God is good.
All the time.
God is good.
All the time.
And all the time. That's much better. So a few weeks ago, we examined Acts 17, verses 6 through 12. We learned that we must examine the scriptures for ourselves. We got to read it. We got to study it. We got to apply it. That was kind of weak on the application part there. Read it. Study it.
Apply it.
Much better. Thank you. Yes, we got to apply it. We got to study it for ourselves. Otherwise, we can be deceived, right? We don't want to be deceived, do we? No, we've got to read this word for ourselves. Tell your neighbor, you better read it.
You
better study it.
You better apply it.
And tonight, I want to pick up where we left off. We're going to go back to verse 6. It says, but when they did not find them, they dragged Jason and some of the other brothers before the city officials, shouting, these men who have caused trouble all over the world have now come here. We talked about this already. I just want to mention again, I would love to be known as a troublemaker for Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
I would like it that when people that don't like Jesus and don't want nothing to do with Jesus get around me, they just get disgusted with themselves and repent and find Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
And Jason has welcomed them into this house. They're all defying Caesar's decree, saying that there is another king, one called Jesus. Verse 8. When they heard this, the crowd and the city officials were thrown into turmoil. Then they made Jason and the others post bond and let them go. As soon as it was night, the brothers sent Paul and Silas away to Berea. On arriving there, they went to the Jewish synagogue. Now, the Bereans were much more of noble character than the Thessalonians, for they received the message with great eagerness and examined the scriptures every day to see if what Paul said was true. Again, this goes back to what we already talked about, examining the scriptures for ourselves. Make sure what you're being taught lines up with this. If it doesn't line up with this, don't stay. Leave. Go away. Do something. Go somewhere else. Find a church that does teach and preach the Bible. Amen?
Amen.
Many of the Jews believed, as did also a number of prominent Greek women and many Greek men. Now, side note, when we can get people to actually read God's word for themselves, and we can expound on the scriptures with them, you know what happens? People get saved. Think about this. When you can get somebody to be interested in God's word, interested enough to pick it up and read it for themselves, do you not think that the Holy Spirit, the author of this book, can speak to them, can draw them, can guide them? What about piquing their interest to be inquisitive enough to ask you or somebody else, what does this mean? Well, what are they talking about here? And then that gives you an opportunity to expound on the scriptures. And I want to talk about testifying tonight. We had testimonies last week. Did y'all enjoy the testimonies last week? Amen. They were good testimonies, right? They told exactly how Jesus had changed them and saved them and how God was using them. It was wonderful, wonderful, wonderful testimonies. I want to talk about testimonies tonight and also talk about expounding on scriptures with people so that they can find Jesus for themselves. The first thing I want you to remember, and I want you to write this down if you're taking notes. If you're taking notes, some of y'all ain't got nothing to take notes with. We'll have to talk about that. Okay? So if you're taking notes, I want you to write this down. If you're not, make a mental note. If you're anything like me, you'll forget it 5 seconds after you leave. It's okay. All right. Mental note. Are you ready for this? This is going to be profound. It's going to be one of the most profound things you'll hear in your entire life. In fact, I think it's so profound, even those of you without pen or paper to take notes will remember what I'm about to say. Nobody needs your opinion. Tonight's title is Opinions Are Like. Ears. Everybody's got at least two, right? Opinions are like. Nobody needs your opinion. Nobody needs my opinion. Don't get me wrong. It's not just your opinion they don't need. They don't need my opinion. They don't need your opinion, my opinion, or anybody else's opinion. What they need is Jesus. They need facts. They need truth. They don't need to know what you think. They need to know who you know. Amen? They don't need your thoughts. They need his facts. Too many of us have based our theology on what we think, on what we feel, what makes us happy, what brings comfort, what makes us feel good about the things that we're doing. I mean, nobody likes to admit that we're wrong, do we? Most of us here have at least come to grips with the first step. Not everybody, but most of us have come up to grips with the first step. Well, does anybody know what step one is of the 12 steps? We have to admit that we got a problem, right? Some of us have issues admitting that we have a problem. And instead, when we're talking about spiritual things, instead of admitting that we have a problem, admitting that we have sin, admitting that we need help, we like to make excuses for our behavior and find scripture or something in there that we can take out of context to make us feel good about what we're doing. Don't believe me? I'll give you a couple of them. I probably don't have to tell you these, but you've already heard them. God made every herb-bearing seed and plant for consumption. Anybody ever used that one before? Yeah. That still don't mean go get high. Okay? Well, God said don't be a drunk. He didn't say not to drink any wine. In fact, there's a passage of scriptures that have a little wine for your stomach. Y'all haven't heard those before, have you? Yeah. Nobody in this room that I know can have just one, so leave it alone because y'all know where we're going to be. Amen?
Amen?
Nobody needs your opinion. What we need is Jesus. How about this? Instead of coming up with scripture you can take out of context and say, God made every herb-bearing seed or plant, or Jesus drank, well, he turned water to wine. Why can't I have wine? Instead of coming up with all these reasons or excuses, why don't you just ask the maker and the creator of the universe, is this right for me? And even if it is permissible, is it beneficial? Please don't be offended. Anybody that may be in the program, I can go ahead and answer that for you. No, it's not beneficial. That's why you're here. Amen?
Amen.
Don't need your opinions. We need his facts. This means when we testify, we don't say, well, I think this is what Jesus wants. I believe, I feel like God may be okay with that. No. We need to call an ace and a spade, don't we? We need to be honest and true. We need to share his word, his facts, his truth. And if you don't know, don't make it up. Go look it up. Amen?
Amen.
Don't just share what you think. Somebody asks you a question, you don't know. Look, I know a lot of things, and I've forgotten a lot of things. Somebody asked me the other day, what is that writing on the tallit say over here, the prayer shawl? And I was like, man, I used to know that. I done forgot it. Hold on. Let's find it in Google. It means, and I told him exactly what it said. I done forgot what it said again, so don't ask me, okay? I have to Google it again, okay? Go ahead and get your cell phone and look it up. Teasing. If you don't know, find out. Find out together. Research it with each other. Ask somebody. Get the information. Write it down. Research it. Share the truth. Share fact. If you don't know, look it up. In fact, I'd rather tell somebody I don't know than I would to lead them astray. Even if I didn't mean to, even if my intentions were good, why on earth would I want to share something that wasn't factual or that wasn't 100% known? You say, well, preacher, there's a lot of different ways to interpret things. There is. And yes, on most ways, things that need interpretation, I have my opinion, but nobody needs my opinion, do they? And in fact, if there's a really controversial doctrine or teaching, and somebody asks me flat out, preacher, what does that mean? I'm going to tell them, well, you got a couple different camps on that. You got some people that believe this about this teaching, and you've got some people that believe this about this teaching. On this particular teaching, I may believe this, or I may believe that, or I may believe this, and I'll tell you why I believe it, but I'm also going to tell you you need to pray about it and ask the Holy Spirit what He's telling you. See? I believe certain things. I also know that some of the things I believed for a long time in my life, God shattered. And I don't believe those things anymore. We have a way of growing, amen? Amen? We have a way of changing. We don't need to share opinion. We need to share truth. If we don't know, look it up. Tell somebody, I don't know. Don't, number two, if you're taking notes. Everybody get the first one, no opinions. Second one, are you ready for this? Don't twist the word of God to fit your lifestyle. I only got one amen out of that. That's ridiculous. Come on. Don't twist the word of God to fit your lifestyle. Amen. Thank you. Twist your lifestyle to fit the word of God. Amen. Amen. We don't need to twist His word to fit what we're doing. We need to change what we're doing to make sure it lines up with His word. If God says don't do it, then don't do it. There are some pretty specific scriptures in the Bible that says no drunkard, no homosexual, no liar, no cheat, no thief will inherit the kingdom of God. I don't know how you can twist that and make any of that okay, but people do it every day. Don't be twisting God's word. If you're a drunkard, a liar, a homosexual, a cheater, or a thief, change it. Give your life to Christ and let Him change you. Twist your lifestyle to fit His word. If you're called out, if you get caught doing something you know you ought not to do, don't make excuses for it. Admit you're wrong. Admit to God you're wrong. Repent. Apologize. He'll help you overcome it. He'll help you change. Number three, if you're taking notes, and this one may surprise you, then again, it may not. We're all sinners. You know who that includes? Tell your neighbor, me. We're all sinners. That means we're all in the same boat. That means those of us who've had the worst possible life, the worst possible experiences, have had the most heartache, the most hurt, the most pain, the most rejection, the most abuse, are in the exact same boat as those that have never experienced even an ounce of what we others may have gone through. It puts us all on a level playing field. Nobody's better, nobody's worse. We all need Jesus, plain and simple. Whoever you're speaking to, whomever you're witnessing to, is valuable. They're important. Look, if you're in any form of leadership at this church or at this ministry, if you lead a small group, if you serve on the altar team, if you serve on the praise team, if you're a teacher, a preacher, if you're on the board of directors, if you wash the laundry at the men's house, if you cook the food, if you order the food, if you're running that camera right now, I want you to understand something. Everybody you speak to, everybody God puts in your path, every lady that shows up at the ladies' ministry, every guy that shows up at the men's ministry, every customer that goes to the thrift store, every house you show up to mow, everything you do, everyone you meet, everyone is valuable. Christ gave his life for that person. Yes, even the most aggravating, most annoying, most obnoxious individual you meet in your life. And tell me you ain't met him. Look at y'all. Some of you are like, I know him. I'm sitting right next to him right now. Okay? Okay? Yeah. They are valuable. They are valuable. Everybody is valuable. They're important to God. You're not better than anybody else. Christ died for them. We need to meet people on their level. Now, I want you to understand something. That doesn't mean we need to act like they act. If they have a vulgar mouth, we don't have to have a vulgar mouth to meet them on their level. In fact, we can even just tell them, you know, that's a 3-page essay, if I hear that again. No, you don't have to have a vulgar mouth. You don't have to, and to meet people on their level, you don't have to act and behave like they do. You have to recognize they need Jesus and meet them at that point of need to tell them. And don't pretend to be more intelligent than you are. Anytime you try to pretend to be something you're not or be more intelligent than you actually are, it just makes you look dumb. Seriously. I know this because it's happened to me on more than one occasion. Yeah. Don't try to be more intelligent. Look, if you talk plain and when you try to witness or speak or teach, don't try to use $10, $15 words that nobody understands. You're probably going to use them in the wrong context anyways. And then somebody who actually knows what that word is going to be looking, well, what's this guy talking about? If when you speak about cricks and errs. Creeks, crooks, crooks, cricks, tars and errs. Then when you testify, let it be the same. Amen?
Amen.
Rely on the Holy Spirit to guide you. In where and when and with whom you are to share. Not everybody's ready or ripe for what you have to say. Now here's what will happen. I just got to tell you. If I have a testimony to share to Tony, and God hasn't guided me to share that testimony with Tony. Tony, don't mind me picking on you, okay? By the way, he's sexy and he mows it, okay? That's what his shirt says. It's great, right? If I have a testimony to share with Tony, And I do it on my own account, not in God's timing. And Tony ain't ready to receive that message, then he's not going to hear it. Then you know what's going to happen, right? When he is ready and ripe to hear that message, I ain't going to want to tell it again because I already told it once. I'm going to be like, I already told him. I ain't going to tell him again. You see how that works? Or maybe he would have been able to receive it, but because he already heard it once, he ain't going to listen to it again. We need to follow God's guidance on how, with whom, and when to share and what to share. Sometimes you don't have to share every detail of your life to get your point across. Somebody I was talking to today said about their testimony. They was glad they was able to keep it PG, right? Got to keep the testimony PG because, you know, their life wasn't PG. What they experienced wasn't PG, but how they told it, because they were in mixed company, they told it in a PG version, right? Not everything we go through in life's PG. We got to follow his guidance. Scripture tells us that he wishes none to perish, but all have eternal life. So if you don't know the people are valuable, understand this. God died for them. He wants them to be saved. Maybe he wants to use you. Maybe he doesn't. Ask him. It's okay to persuade. It's okay to prove. It's okay to explain. But there's no need to argue. I am not going to get no argument with nobody about doctrine. First of all, I want you to understand something. Just because I'm right and they're wrong doesn't mean nothing. But the reality is, by arguing with somebody, you're never going to change their mind. Amen. But if you love them and you pray for them, the Holy Spirit can get in there and change their heart about the situation. Amen. Titus 3:9. But avoid foolish controversies and genealogies and arguments and quarrels about the law, because they are unprofitable and useless. Romans 14:1. Accept him whose faith is weak without passing judgment on disputable matters. Even the Bible tells us there's disputable matters. You know what? A lot of the things we get hung up on, dispute on, and argue on aren't salvation issues. They have nothing to do with whether somebody's going to heaven or not. Why would you argue with them? 2 Timothy 2:14 says, keep reminding them of these things. Warn them before God against quarreling about words. It is of no value and only ruins those who listen. And I know one of the favorite pastimes at the men's house is to argue scripture, right? Y'all like to get in there and argue. Somebody over here want to argue this. Somebody want to argue this over this. Somebody want to argue this over there. Stop it. It's useless. Don't do it. Pray about it. We are to be those as described in 1 Peter 3:15. Says, but in your heart, set apart Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks. Did you see that? If they ain't asking, you ain't got to be prepared to give the answer, right? It says, be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect, keeping a clear conscience, so that those who speak maliciously against your good behavior in Christ may be ashamed of their slander. If our lives matched what we said, think about this. If our lives matched what we talked about, what we say, everybody and anybody that would try to discredit us would be put to shame. The problem is, we say one thing and then do something else. And then when somebody wants to talk bad about us or slander us or find fault with our religion or find fault with our relationship with Jesus or find fault with us, period, they got plenty of evidence to stand on because we say one thing and we do something else. That makes us double-minded men and women, and a double-minded man, the scripture says, should not have anything that he asks for. They're unstable in all their ways. We like to think, oh, it's okay, I'm only unstable in this way. I'm okay in all these ways. But really, if you're unstable in any way, you're unstable in every way. My walk talk needs to match my talk talk, right? It isn't our opinion we're sharing. It's the word of God we're sharing. 2 Timothy 3 and 16. All scripture. How much?
All.
Can't hear you.
All.
That means those scriptures that you get bogged down in with so-and-so begot so-and-so begot so-and-so begot so-and-so. The ones that have all the names you can't pronounce in them. Yeah. Yeah, all scripture is God breathed. He breathed it all. How is it that we can find some that's more important than others? No, it's all God breathed. All scripture is God breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. His word is true, his word is pure. It's the spoken word that breathed life into all of creation. All things were made by him and through him. Y'all just heard that the other night, right? By him and through him and for him. All things were made. He breathed life. The spoken word breathed life into every living thing. And his written word will bring life into every spiritual dead thing if we let it. His word is life-giving. Your opinion is life-killing. His word is life-giving. Your own thoughts, not based on his word, but your own beliefs, is life-destroying. 2 John 1 and 9. Anyone who runs ahead and does not continue in the teaching of Christ does not have God. I'm about to close, but I got to just talk about a little bit this, okay? Look, I want you to understand something. God loves you. He sent his word to heal you, to change you, to set you free, to save you. If in his name, you take off running after things that aren't for you to run after. If in his name, you go gung-ho doing the things that you think are going to bring glory to him, but they have nothing to do with what he's required of you. You have not continued his teaching. And you do not have God. Church, I want you to understand something. There's going to be some of you that are led by God to go to some deep, deep places with him. There's going to be others of us that God is going to use to help those that are far from him get to know who he is. Amen? God is going to call each of us for a purpose and a plan according to his will, but never step out of his will. And begin to do it your way. Whoever continues in his teaching has both the Father and the Son. Anyone who, go ahead to the next verse, verse 10. If anyone comes to you and does not bring this teaching, do not take him to your house or welcome him. Sherry, I want you to understand something. Y'all probably heard this a million times. I'm going to say it again as the praise team gets ready to come up here and we get ready to close. Show me your friends and I'll show you your
future.
I couldn't hear you. Let me again. Show me your friends and I'll show you your
future.
This scriptural, if anyone comes to you and does not bring this teaching, anyone, any friend, any relative, any cousin, any sister, any aunt and uncle together. Anybody comes to you not bringing this teaching, they're not to even be welcomed in your house. If they can't be with you in your relationship with God, they have no welcome even in your house. Because if you let them in your house, they'll wiggle in your heart. And before you know it, you'll be so far away from God that you're not even where he brought you to. Now, I don't know the condition of everybody's heart that entered this place tonight, but God does. I don't know if you're close to him or you're far from him. But if you're here tonight and you know that you've been living your life not according to his word, but based on your own opinion. Maybe you're here tonight and you've been sharing your opinion, sharing your thoughts, freely giving advice to those that are around you, knowing that that has nothing to do with the word of God, but just makes you feel better about yourself. If that's you tonight, I want you to be at this altar to repent. I told you earlier, if you're wrong, admit you're wrong. Admit it to God. Ask for forgiveness. Receive forgiveness. Change your ways and change your behavior. Maybe you're here tonight and you know that you can't honestly say you've really studied his word to know it. Maybe you've wrote a few outlines and gone through the motions so you can feel like you've done what you need to do. But you know deep down in here, you haven't loved his word. You haven't let it teach you. You haven't let it change you. Then tonight, I'm going to ask you to be this altar to repent, to commit your life to him, commit your life to change, to find victory. In just a moment, when this altar opens, and I'm not going to only ask for those two decisions to be made, I'm going to ask you to examine yourself. You know if you've been fooling yourself. You know if you've been sincere. And if there's anything in you that says that maybe you just haven't been real, you've just been holding on to that middle ground, then I'm going to ask you to come and join me at the altar. Will you stand with me as we close? Father, we thank you. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your victory. Lord, I'm asking right now that you'll begin to do a mighty work within us, Lord, that will release us from our opinions, release us from our inappropriate behaviors, from our traditions, and get us in your word to live for you. In Jesus' name, the altar's open. Will you come?
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies. Till all my fears are gone, child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. From my mother's womb, you have chosen me. Love has called my name, and I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows. goes through my veins. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. Child of God.
Somebody that knew me from a while ago, and he was in the program in the men's house. It used to be a church, and he reminded me how I used to be. I was a quiet, shy, and I sat in the back quiet the whole time. I didn't say anything, which I knew that God called me for the ministry. I knew it, but the fear that clouded me that time, the fear that I let the enemy lie to me for a long time.
Right.
And then the enemy always tell me that if you speak, nobody will understand you because of your accent. And because of that, I shut my mouth for so long, which I knew that God called me to minister. I knew it. Until one day I couldn't stand any longer, and I gave that fear to him, and you know what, he took over, God took over, and this mouth is just doesn't stop now. And but doesn't stop for God, you know. Doesn't stop for God, you know. So You know, but whatever the fear you have, really, Richie, whatever the fear you have right now that stop you, that scare you to move forward, because I know each one of us, we have a calling in our lives. Each one of us, God call us to do something. It could be hands and the feet and the head and the shoulder, whatever it is. God call you to do something. And that fear that stop you to do it, to answer that calling. But you know what? We are His children. And He is a lot bigger. He is a lot stronger than the fear that, you know, that clouded us. And tonight, I want to sing this one, the chorus again. And don't give in to that fear. Let it go. God, give it to God. If He can use this woman from Indonesia all the way here with her mouth, He surely can use you in mighty way. So I want to sing this one more time and tell that fear to go away. I'm no longer a slave to fear. Come on, I am a child of God. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. Come on. Sing it one more time. I'm no longer a slave to fear. Yes, Lord. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child. Child of God. Woo! I'm no longer slave to fear. I am a child of God. Woo! God is good. Thank you.
You've been walking the same old road for miles and miles. If you've been hearing the same old voice tell the same old lies.
Come on, sing it out.
If you're trying to fill the same old holes inside.
Come on.
Come on.
There's a better life. There's a better life. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. You got chains, he's a chain breaker.
Woo!
We've all searched for the light of day in the dead of night. And we've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. And we've all run to things we know just ain't right. There's a better life.
Woo!
There's a better life. You got pain.
Come on, sing it.
He's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. You got chains. He's a chain breaker. If you believe it, if you receive it,
come on now.
If you can feel it, somebody testify.
Somebody testify.
Jesus.
If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it,
come on, testify now.
Testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. You got pain. He's a pain taker. If you feel lost,
come on, church.
He's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. You've got chains, he's a chain breaker. You've been walking the same old road for miles and miles. If you've been hearing the same old voice tell the same old lies. You're trying to fill the same old holes inside.
Come on, there's a better life.
There's a better life.
Yes, there is.
There's a better life. You got pain. He's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. You got chains, he's a chain breaker.
If you believe it,
if you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify.
Jesus!
If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can't feel it,
come on, everybody!
Somebody testify.
Testify!
If you believe it, if
the fire.
Jesus!
You got pain. He's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's the way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. You got chains, he's a chain breaker.
Hallelujah!
You know, talking about the arguing about the scripture, arguing about your belief, arguing about the thing. You know, please don't do that. Don't do it. You know, the other way that you can argue with other people about your belief about Jesus and everything through your life. Because you know why? You know, they can argue. If it's a they see that your lives is, they see Jesus through your life. What can they argue about? Nothing. Or, just like me tonight, I'm arguing my point to my friends wearing a shirt. And I know that she's watching. And guess what? I'm wearing the shirt. So, that you can do that too, without even have to argue. Right? Like Tony. Like Tony. Hey, nobody can argue that he's a sexy, right? He's sexy. Nobody argue that. Nobody can argue because he has a shirt. Yes. But it's really useless to argue your point. You know, if you stand up for something, show it through your life. Show it through your life. And then make the point. I stand for my country, I wear the shirt. Amen.
Great is our God. Sing with me. How great is our God. And all will see how great is our God. Great is our God, and sing with me how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God.
How great is our God.
our God. How great is our God. And sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great. How great. Great is our God, and sing with me how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God.
Come on, sing it one more time. How great is our God.
Great is our God, and sing with me how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God.
And all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of men, you are here before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're worth. Crucified, laid behind the song, you live. You took the form and thought of me above all, and like a rose trampled on the ground, you took the form and thought of me.
Hallelujah. Y'all give the Lord a hand. Yeah.
Amen and amen and amen. God is good. I'm so glad my wife ain't shy no more. Richie, close us in prayer, but don't make it an error.
Father in heaven, we thank you for the night. We thank you for all the things that you do for us, Lord. We know that as long as we're walking with you, Lord, that we'll, our troubles will not be there, Lord, and that you'll be there for us. Lord, we just thank you for everything, each and every day. We pray in Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.